We're going to be talking to you guys about something super interesting today, or something I know nothing about. So apparently there's this thing called private equity, and it involves like huge amounts of money, money that entrepreneurs really need. And these experts are going to be talking to us about this subject. I'll introduce them to you shortly. We have our moderator, Mr. Hassan Masoud from Ilma News. We have Mr. Amr Abaish from Tanmaya. We have Mr. Waleed Bokr from Abroj Group, and Mr. Ahmed Al-Gindi from EFG Hermes. And I'll hand the mic over to Hassan now so he can tell us a bit more about this interesting subject, which you all must be super interested in. Let's get going.
Hi. Hassan Masoud, Menus. I'll be moderating this panel. Just to be clear, you're going to be hearing from these experts about private equity. This side is just asking the questions. So very briefly, the reason we thought this talk might be interesting is that private equity, as you'll hear soon from Waleed more specifically, is a form of investing. It's a form of investing in companies at a kind of a large scale. And lately we're seeing that the space between private equity investing and the kind of tech and entrepreneurship space seems to be kind of thinning, and there's more and more overlap between the two. So that's kind of the idea behind this panel. So with that, I'll give it to every one of our panelists who can introduce themselves, explain to you what they do and what their institution does.
My name is Amr Abaish. I'm the chairman and CEO of Tanmaya Micro Enterprise Services. We are a microfinance company. We give loans to micro enterprises like the likes of kiosks, grocery stores, and artisans. Nationwide, we have 115 branches. We are a 1,500 employee firm today. And we are the second largest provider of microloans in the country. These loans are money for entrepreneurs to finance their working capital. This company has been established nearly 7 years ago, 6.5 years ago. And just for clarity, I should be on your side of the equation because I was a recipient of private equity funds to support the establishment of my country. A company.
Hi, my name is Waleed Bakr, managing director with a company called the Abroj Group. We're a global private equity firm, as I'm going to explain now, investing currently in over 30 markets across the globe, from Latin America to Southeast Asia. But we're really proud that our roots and our beginnings as an entrepreneurial company, entrepreneurial journey, actually started here in the region in the Middle East. In a nutshell, private equity, is just a fancy term for something very simple. We utilize funds by investors to acquire stakes primarily in private companies, either through injecting additional capital in these companies or acquiring existing shareholders, buying their shares. Typically, we invest in companies with a mature business model, not necessarily a mature company, but with a mature business model, with the objective of utilizing our resources and potentially the money we invested in these companies to help them scale to the next level. Typically, the term private equity covers the whole domain of investing in private companies, starting from a minute startup all the way to a very large-scale company. However, the terminology used now in the market, whenever people usually segregate between venture capital, which is essentially private equity in startups or early stage company, versus using the term private equity, which means companies are usually of a larger scale, have proven their business model, have reached a certain scale that varies from one place to the other, and hopefully with the support of investors like us with other private equity firms, we can help take them to the next level. We can get local champions, make them regional champions. We can get regional champions, make them global companies. And over the course of this session, we'll discuss about a few examples of that. Thanks.
Good afternoon. My name is Ahmed Al-Gindi. I head investment banking for EFG Hermes. Investment banking is, in a nutshell, or at least what we do, is we advise companies on buying or selling shares of other companies or their own, if you will, and also help investors and high net worth individuals find the right opportunities to invest, being or advising actually management teams or companies on how to raise money. So I'll have to reiterate what Amr said, and I'll try to corner Waleed. I should be sitting on this side of the room, not on this side. So I mean, we're dealing with private equities almost on a daily basis, but usually as advisor, we sit on the other side of the table, side of the manager, the operator that is trying to raise money, be it from institutional sources or from family offices.
If you're confused by what Ahmed said, that's because this is intentional. He's very good at sitting at every side of the table. So Ahmed, actually, let me take this back to you. So in your capacity in advising investors and companies in transactions, a lot of the folks that you advise are private equity firms or, you know, different private equity type institutions and animals. Might be helpful to kind of give a quick overview of what are the different types of private equity firms that are in the market today. Overview of what they do and what type of private equity firms are kind of entering the market as you see it.
Sure. So just to give you a flavor of the market, I would say you have a few big players in the market. On top of them is definitely Abraj, where Waleed comes from. You have also Actis. You have a couple of other names. Those firms have international presence with a clear focus on emerging markets. And these are the main players in Egypt. Aside from the big players, you also have some regional funds that have started mainly in GCC and have come to Egypt as a natural expansion. I would say that maybe you'll find them doing two, three investments in Egypt per fund, for example. But again, the main focus would still be GCC. Other than that, you'll find some Africa-focused funds, mainly based out of London, that also are starting to look at Egypt more seriously as an African jurisdiction. This being said, I would say that the main criterion that almost you'll find common among all those players is their focus on a ticket size that would usually range from $40 to $75 million in most cases. Most of them coming to the region or coming to Egypt, they would rather invest in a buyout transaction, so buying control, buying 51% or more of the company, rather than providing growth capital. But this being said, also you'll find, you know, some opportunities on the growth or some investments actually on the growth capital side. The main challenge, I would say, for them coming in a minority position would be how to guarantee the rights. How, for example, they can trigger a divestment event, how they can make sure that management is compensated fairly for delivering, but also how can they initiate change if for any reason the operator or the management or the controlling shareholder with whom they have had this partnership is not delivering on their initial promises. So again, I mean, I would say that the commercial agreement or the sale and purchase of shares is one agreement that takes time, but usually the shareholders agreement or the agreement that governs the relationship going forward between the investor and the founders is the more difficult and the trickier part of the transaction documentation, if you will.
No, absolutely. So in kind of doing the kind of thinking around this panel and how to structure it and what really are the points of intersection between private equity and you know kind of the tech and entrepreneurship scene, we've kind of identified three really distinct themes and three really distinct situations where private equity seems to be involved in this space. One is scenarios where a tech company startup matures, you know, becomes dominant in its industry, gets to a scale of, you know, being investable at a scale of, you know, $40 to $75 million, and is then acquired by a private equity firm. And you know, I think the kind of most famous example of that lately here in the market in Egypt is the acquisition of Fawri. By actually a group of private equity firms and kind of pools of capital that are quasi-private equity firms. Then the second kind of example of that is of private equity and being involved in the scene is private equity funds investing in earlier stage companies. So in a company that you would typically has only had venture capital backers so far, and you know, all of a sudden, you know, a transaction is announced and there's a private equity investor in you know, their latest round. And you know, I think there's kind of a recent example of that with Abraj participating in the latest capital increase of Kareem Cars, which is a ride-hauling app out of Dubai. I'm sure you guys have heard of it. And then the third, and you know, even more peculiar type of involvement for private equity and kind of backing entrepreneurs is a scenario where, you know, a private equity firm backs an entrepreneur to start a company with knowing that this is a, you know, a ultimately a $40 to $75 million transaction, but you know, they decide that they're going to back an entrepreneur and start it from day one and be shareholders in the company really from day zero of the history of this company. And you know, kind of you know, I think one of the most successful examples of that is Tanmeya Microfinance, which is Amr's brainchild. That was started by Amr as the entrepreneur and backed by a private equity firm called Citadel Capital. And so it would be fantastic to kind of explore each one of these themes, each one of these types of investing in by private equity in this ecosystem. And maybe
I actually suggest
yes.
You start the journey.
You start the journey. Fair enough, yeah, that's kind of the more logical flow. Sure.
Okay, prior to entering this session, I was discussing with Hassan that I would like to give you a little bit of the personal angle of things. I just want to ask a question of the audience. How many of you are aspiring to establish their own business or are in the process of doing so? Okay. So we're all together in it. Just like you, at the age of a little bit later than you, at the age of 37, myself and two colleagues, I used to work in microfinance and I was a banker and decided that this model is going to work, regardless of what the model is. But basically, there is a market gap in providing loans to the low income groups in Egypt to support their businesses. So these are not consumer loans. These are loans to support buying merchandise. And the gap is humongous. And Egypt, like in a lot of things, is not equitable in its distribution of financing resources. So all of us are coming out of the Jan 2011 events and later and all the subsequent events. So we all know about inequity as a word, and we would look at the figures and find out that from the banking sector, 2% of Egyptian enterprises received 94% of the money given out by Egyptian banks, okay? Which leaves the majority of 98% of those enterprises receiving only 6% of this money. So if you want the SME sector and the micro enterprise sector to grow in Egypt, and this is the base of any economy worldwide, it's not going to happen with this money. And lending to those people, to those very, very promising individuals and enterprise owners, the gap is humongous to the extent that only 10% at that time of the demand for loans was met, and 90%, no loans. Okay, Egypt has loan sharks. Egypt is full of loan sharks all the way back to the ancient Egyptians. Okay, and you'd think that at a modern age you would have lenders in the market, you didn't. And this is the premise of our company and this is the core of our company. And by the way, for you to know, if you want to borrow money from loan sharks in Egypt, it's a pound for a pound every year. Okay, so you borrow £1, you pay it £1 or £1.5 back. That's 150% interest rate. Okay, and hence the idea, what would stop us from actually penetrating this market and capitalizing on this and bringing banks' money to areas and people that do not normally access or have access to this money for a variety of reasons. As bank employees, the three of us, we put this in 2007, we put this idea on paper, and we're very weary of what will happen and whether or not we can take it forward. To start with, we approached the government. We went to the post office and said, you have 3,000 branches nationwide. You have a lot of money. Let's help you. Okay, get this money to the people. And till today, we didn't receive an answer. So, okay. So this was the after being very excited about writing the idea on paper and getting out a business plan, our first shock was no answer from the post office. And not to mention that this person we knew in the head of the post office was actually a friend, and Bardo, he didn't answer. Then we got a little bit demotivated, worked a little bit on the idea, and we went to one certain private equity firm, okay. And we told him, listen, we have a brilliant idea, and he said, how much investment do we need? Here we had two options. We can be majority shareholders, own 70, 80, 90% of this business, but our business plan would have two branches. Or we can be minority shareholders, and that's something that comes to your mind, at least it came to mind when you're partnering up with someone. Are you willing to give up a majority power? Okay. And be minority shareholders and own and establish 100 branches. So we went to this prominent private equity firm, and they said, how much money do you need to make a very big company? We said, we needed £35 million. And he said, how much money do you guys have? We said, we have three. And he said, okay, but I'm going to get, sorry, this is too small for my taste. I don't do anything below £500 million. And then we walked out. Again, extremely demotivated. We went back to the government again and said, you have the cooperatives. You know the cooperatives? El Ahram, Sumanil. You know how many there are nationwide? Does anybody know? 45,000 shops nationwide. And we said, let's do a partnership, utilize a part of those cooperatives and get money, and we have the expertise and deliver this product. And the government, this time they responded. They said, absolutely, but we never saw them again. Okay, and one demotivational curve, and I'm giving this a very personal angle because I understand totally if you're sitting aspiring for partnership and investment. And I'm actually going to say something good about venture capital. So this is, I'm sorry, about private equity. And
something good is coming at some point, right? Yeah.
And it took us 2 years. And then until by coincidence, actually Waleed was one of the people we sat with a long time ago. Okay.
So impersonally.
And until one day, we met with this representative of a large Saudi bank group. We sat down with him in the lobby of one of the hotels, an Egyptian gentleman, a very nice guy. And he said, how much funding do you need to push over to those people? Do you need 1 billion, 2 billion pounds? And we're not used to those numbers, Yanni. Like you, I mean, 100,000 is a big figure. It's, Yanni, 500,000 is huge. 1 million is humongous, Yanni. To get the statement like that, 1 billion pounds was a shocker, Taban. We all went home super happy and very excited, and we sent him an email, we need 2 billion Egyptian pounds, please. And amazingly enough, they responded and said, deal. Okay. I swear to you, I would have cried that night. I nearly did, but it was too embarrassing. There were a lot of people sitting. And we went back and took a step backwards, and we started looking at what the parameters of the deal would be, and we discovered that although we were bankers and we were senior bankers, okay, we had no idea of how those deals done on the investment banking level and the private equity firms were. So I called up a friend who is a partner in Citadel Capital at that point in time, and now Kala Holding. I said, listen, I'll give him this credit, Hisham. Listen, Hisham, we have this business plan. We got an offer from another private equity firm, and that's what they're offering. And these guys are willing to put £35 million as we requested, and this is the deal they're offering us. And of course, all of this is dilemma. All through this process, you never believe this is going to go through. It's too good to go through. Yeah, I mean, it's too good to happen. It's like somebody came from outer space and said, I'll give you money. And then we got an answer back saying, guys, we'd love to go into a partnership with you, and we'll give you a better offer. Are you putting all your money? I said, I swear, I still have my car that I can sell. And I have a family asset, but I can't sell that. Yes, yani, لو عايزيني أرهنها, I will do that, yani. They said, no, that's fine. Furthermore, we'll sign you up and give you guys another 10% of the company, and we established the company. And I have to say this in Arabic, sorry. اللقطة اللي جاية بقى is the peak of everything, yani, it's like the next snapshot. Was we found ourselves sitting in an office that we rented in Maadi with £35 million in the bank. And it was like, can we use profanity here? Oh shit. We have 35 million and I have a signatory authority, my colleagues and I, of up to £24 million. We can just sign it without going back to the private equity firm, yani. You realize the humongous responsibility that you have on your back. All of this, and we were so confident of our business plan, but when it comes to reality, you're not that confident, okay? And we are very, very shaky at that point in time. And we'd rented an apartment for $2,000 a month, and we're already panicking, okay? And £35 million in the bank. So the one thing we had to do. Oh, yeah. The day we were meant to sign the establishment of this company, we had a partner bank. And the partner bank is the main source of funding, because by Egyptian laws, until last November, no entity in Egypt was allowed to give loans out to people or companies, only banks. So we had to sign a bank on board to source those loans. And we had a deal, and that's another amazing thing. We gave up on finding banks. We needed £400 million. Our dreams on paper, yani. 420 million, I remember the calculation very well, £420 million to finance our portfolio for the first 3 years. And taban, you go into a bank, say, I need you to trust me to give me your money that I would give to 100,000 other people, and that's only £420 million. And as a banker, I know how crap that sounds, yani. How crappy that sounds. And until we walked into the Egyptian Gulf Bank, one of the very small banks in Egypt, and we went into the CEO's office, and I said, I need £420 million, after saying hi and everything. And he said, okay, done. We love this. Do you have a business plan? We gave him the business plan, and he said, we're on board. The night we were supposed to sign the agreement, this guy calls me up and says, sorry, we're not in. And I had the mission of calling up the private equity firm to say, sorry, the bank is not in. No, we hadn't taken the money. So this
But was the money still there after that happened?
Yes.
Okay, good.
They signed. And not to prolong, tell you.
Let me cut you off right there. Sorry. I want to kind of give credit to the all the different possibilities of private equity investments in the space. I don't know if the transaction with Karim involved as much drama in Abraj's case.
So sorry, we cannot trump Amr's great stories.
It is not going to happen.
Or typically, so if we do, it's under non-disclosure, so we don't talk about them. So I'm not gonna, you know, pre-qualify my statement by saying I sit on your side of the table, because obviously I sit on by myself on one side
of
the table.
Let me ask you kind of more specifically, what was it about Karim in terms of the maturity of that company or the maturity of the space or presumably both that made you think, okay, this is now something that we can be involved with?
Because I mean, it's if you listen to how I define private equity, it fell within the space. As I said, we invest in companies that have a mature business model. I've never said a mature business, but it has a mature business model, and this is where we fall. So Karim, as a company, and if some of you don't know the company, Karim is sort of the Uber of the Middle East and beyond. It's expanding beyond the Middle East now. It's not an Uber lookalike. It has actually some interesting features which got us interested in the platform. More interestingly, their growth plans. But we looked at a company that it's been around for almost 2.5 years operational. It has proven itself that it managed to achieve scale. They have proven the business model. They have proven elements of the business case that we were interested to see. Accordingly, we had high confidence into the other elements that are coming online. And more importantly, when we look at companies, we don't only look at scale, but we also look at scalability. And by scalability, we're looking at how fast and how efficiently are they growing, but also the potential for them to take that to the next level. And it's an interesting aspect that, you know, when you sit down with companies that we talk to who say, you know, we have an interesting business that we want you to look at, and usually people talk about either how successful their business is or how big their business is. While what we are interested in is how their business can grow, and more importantly, when it comes to success, we don't ask people, when you say your business is successful, you usually talk about, you know, how big it is, your market share, your profitability, and all of this. And we ask people, why were you successful? And you'll be surprised how many companies out there actually do not understand or realize how they managed to reach that scale, how they managed to capture that. There are companies that would succeed out there because they are timing the market, or because, you know, the opportunity is good, or, you know, the weather is clear. And companies like that are abundant, but this is not where we can play a role. So Karim ticked all the boxes. They've proven their model, they've proven their case, they achieved scale, they were growing fast, the market opportunity was good, and they had scalability. And they were at the size where it fitted the kind of investment tickets we were talking about, so it was on the lower end, but they were meeting that. And more importantly, the platform that companies like us had were able to support them where they wanted to expand, whether geographically, where we had resources on the ground that can support them, or with certain elements of their business model or the next stage of growth that we can help them unlock. So not only that they have clarity on where they want to go, but also we have the resources to support them on their way to go. And by the way, you know, a lot of people are saying, you know, this is Abraj's first venture into that space. Actually, it's our second. Our first is a very old story, which is about 10 years old. We decided at that time to go in a company that probably was smaller than Karim at that stage, but it was just on this inflection point, proven their business model, had scale, were about to grow, and that's a company that everybody in this room knows, which is Maktoub. We were the first large institutional investor in Maktoub, and we took it to a great scale, and it was a great story. And I dare say, since we exited our position in 2007, we have been looking at the market and waiting for the next one.
Wow, so. Okay. So we'll get back to you and kind of try to understand more of what you're looking at, because I'm sure there's a lot of people here in the room that kind of look at what happened with Karim and are kind of thinking, okay, how do I check these boxes? And I think that's a very reasonable question. Ahmed, Fawri is a very interesting company. I think it's probably safe to say that 2 years ago, they would not have been PE investable, not by any stretch of the imagination. But today they are, and they're invested by, you know, some even non-traditional private equity players in this market. So curious to hear your take as to, you know, what do you think were kind of the last three kind of things that needed to come into place for the Fawri either to happen as a deal or for Fawri as a company and a business model to mature enough to be investable by you know, someone like Helios and the Wellcome Trust and these guys.
Sure.
sure I'll start, but by what made it interesting for us, because I guess that's what also made it interesting for the private equity players that ended up investing in the company. So just to give you again a color on what we're doing together with two friends and colleagues who are present in this room, Amr and Magid, we cover different sectors. So again, I mean, before becoming a generalist banker, I used to cover the telecom and technology space together with the financial services space. So for a financial technology player or a fintech player to be available and to be that successful in Egypt, definitely, I mean, it was something that definitely caught our attention. More importantly for us, because I mean, we're not on the buy side, we're on the advisory side. So for us, it's not the size of the ticket, it's the quality of the management team. So the minute we met management, and after definitely, I mean, not the minute, but after a couple of meetings, we understood that we're backing the right management team. Our role is to position the company, is to build the investment story in a way that is understandable to the private equity players, but the first selling point in any business, and especially in this size and in this sphere, is the quality of the management team. So that's the second point. The third point that we liked also about the company is the scalability. The fact that it can act as a platform for other services, for other jurisdictions, and again, you have a management team with a vision and with an ambition to grow it to meet these expectations. So once those factors were on the table, we knew that, I mean, it's the right target to take to market. I would add to this, and again, I mean, this is also one thing that I would urge you to really consider, is governance. By virtue, for example, of having IFC on the table, we knew what to expect even before indulging into the first task of business diligence. Again, it's very simplistically, it's the way the company is managed, the way, for example, the board is composed, the way management is compensated, the way the decision-making process is taken. So again, forget about profits, forget about numbers, and think for a minute about the process behind it, the kitchen that will serve for you to get to these numbers. Because again, and I mean without names, but do not be surprised if you find businesses in Egypt making operating profits of $10 and $20 million and not paying sales tax. Actually, it happens. And for those kind of players, no matter how good the business is or the management team is, it's not usually the businesses that we would like to back. And definitely, the same view will be taken by every reputable private equity house. Because again, it doesn't only affect, you know, your view on the business and on the work ethic that existed in the business, but also the mindset of people that eventually you will become partner with. So again, I mean, definitely numbers and success and quality of management is one angle on the business side, but corporate governance is as important, if not even more important in some cases, for the company to be investable from a private equity point of view.
Ahmed, before I get back to you with a follow-up question, so we're going to have open up questions to the audience. So in a couple of minutes, we'll be doing that. So think of any questions that you might have for the panel here. Ahmed, let me kind of further ask you. You're in the market. You see kind of what companies are coming up. Where do you see excitement from investors, frankly, private equity or even beyond, about the in the tech space in Egypt? So do you see interest? Where do you see the pockets of that interest? Do you see interest localized maybe in a particular sector versus others?
So actually, before the audience starts asking questions, maybe I can ask them a question. So I mean, since the revolution in 2011, which sector do you think has grown fastest in Egypt? Do you think, for example, is it dairy? Is it confectionery? Is it carbonated soft drinks? I mean, F&B in general. Let me tell you this, because I mean, we're surprised by the numbers. It's mobile broadband. Connectivity has grown with around 49% year after year. So again, I mean, that's a CAGR. It's not in any single year. So it's a market that is doubling 1.5 times every single year consistently for the last 4 years. So we're dealing with a generation that is becoming more connected and that is looking for efficiencies in every single aspect of their lives based on this connectivity. So again, I mean, financial services that have a very solid technical backbone, I guess, is one area that has attracted interest and that will continue to attract interest. And mind you, the conventional organizations today, and again, maybe to Amp's point, are serving a very small fraction of the population, while the larger, actually, portion is coming on stream, is coming connected, and is looking for a quality service.
So at the risk of getting cheeky, we have a big private equity player sitting here on the table. Are you, I don't know, which one? Would you corroborate that? Do you see interest in theoretical private equity firms in a fintech space?
I mean, listen, I mean, it's one of the areas we're looking at, and we never say that, but there are very few companies in the world, I mean, in my track record at least, that I regret not investing in, and Fauri is sadly one of them. So this is one side of the table I wanted to be at, but it didn't happen at that time. No, fintech is a very interesting space for us because it's actually the intersection of three different things, of, you know, financial services, that we see lots of opportunities in the market. Egypt is still on a very nascent curve, particularly when it comes to consumer financial services. The other intersection is technology, because fintech is financial services that are enabled by technology. So we're seeing, you know, mobility growing, you know, growth in mobile broadband, but also in awareness and adaption by people of mobile tech. And the third intersection, while it might be surprising to a lot of people here, we actually are feeling the pulse of the government that is really opening up towards really, you know, supporting innovation at large in a lot of services, not innovation in the classical scientific sense, but innovation in a lot of services as an economic enabler. The government doesn't know what needs to be done. Is hoping that there are others who know what needs to be done and they're willing to listen and open up. So the intersection of these three is presenting an immense opportunity. The only sad thing is there are only, you know, one or two or three Fauris out there, Fauri likes, in fintech, while in a country with 90 million people, we should be expecting thousands of them.
Absolutely.
So hopefully it's growing.
Well, let's hope if any of those entrepreneurs end up going to the government and or the post or any organ of the government, they at least get a response back at some point. It doesn't have to be of any particular kind. Anyway, questions? I don't control that, so Hidayat. Yeah, Hidayat has a mic.
Okay. I'm sorry, it's not a question, but I'd really love to hear the rest of the story. Yes, I want to know what happened.
Let's give others. Yeah, it's a very, very, very long story, and I promise you, he didn't even get to the interesting part. He did not even get to the interesting part. There are villains that become the good guys, and then the good guys become the villains, and it's fascinating. But you need to give the story its credit. So let's give somebody else an opportunity.
I'm Sarkhir. Ism Muhammad. I have a couple of questions. First one is, as a private equity firm, I assume as you step in, you definitely have some agenda and objectives in mind. And it's no secret that this brings a lot of doubts into the mind of business owners. They may think that there is a conflict of interest or some changes will happen which is not in their favor. So what is your view on this? What are the pros and cons of having a private equity firm stepping in?
I think that's one for Amr.
It's very simple. The pros is money. Okay? It's a bottom line. Basic. These guys, when they come in, they give you money that enables scalability. Okay, at least in our case, that was how it is. And regardless of the details, in our case, this start-off with this amount of capital made so much more relevance to the extent that if you reduce it by half, it's not going to be half the startup. It's going to be so much less. One definite thing is, one definite pro is money. One definite perceived as a con at that point in time was losing control. Okay, there is a majority shareholder on your board that, if they want, will call the shots and can easily overrule management. So the thing is that it has to be a very careful equation. Know your partner very well. and outline as much as possible what kind of deal you have as management. At the end of the day, in this equation, you're not just a business owner as a minority, you have management. And honestly, it worked out towards the end, which is now because we're being sold, it worked out very well. I have to hand it over to the private equity firm. So,
let me just add something very little. When, particularly when you go into companies and you have, you know, entrepreneurs or founders on the board, partnership is very much like a marriage. You want to be with somebody that you're willing to be with for the rest of your life. Now, if that groom or bride is, you know, wealthy, the wealthier she is, the better, the prettier she is, you know, if she has a house and a boat, that's great. But it's somebody that you'd be willing to sit on the table with for reasons, not only for money, because you need to be ready. If you're a really good company, there will be a million people out there who are gonna who are willing to write checks. You need to be able to work with somebody that you believe that you and him together can take it to the next level. Sometimes it's just chemistry, sometimes it's, you know, there's science to it, you know, what he can bring to the table. But there is a certain level of alignment that you need to have from day zero to avoid getting into a situation of conflicts of interest. Conflicts will happen, but you should both be in love enough to be able to resolve it. I mean, it might sound very, you know, melodramatic, but this is really how it is at the end of the day.
Absolutely. There was, oh my God, there's a lot of questions. Hidayat? Hidayat, we can do more than one question. It's fine. Who does?
It's okay.
Bite me. We'll sit here. There's a lot of questions in the back.
My name is Salma Al-Hariri. I used to run an accelerator program that bridged between San Francisco and Silicon Valley and what's happening in the region. And I currently run an online platform that is government-owned that promotes entrepreneurship and innovation. And my question to you is basically, what do you believe is the role of private equity in building the VC as an asset class in the Middle East?
Waleed? Are you, can I twist your question a little bit just to make it a little bit more uncomfortable for him? Where are you about starting a proper VC fund?
We're not. We've helped, I mean, if you all know here probably in the room about WAMDA. WAMDA was actually, you know, conceived inside of Abraj. And it's, you know, it evolved outside of Abraj, and we backed the startup of WAMDA. We funded their first fund to get them on their feet. So our role as a private equity player, out of our commitment to the region, out of our desire to see not one Karim, not one Fauri, but millions of them, we'll continue to be committed. We'll continue to help work with other players to promote like that. If we're, you know, if we mention an event like Rise Up was inspired by an event that Abraj organized 5 years ago in Dubai called Celebration of Entrepreneurship, which is by far still, you know, hopefully the largest event until Rise Up 2016. So we are doing our best to promote the ecosystem, to help more of these players grow. We'll talk to VCs who are gonna tell us what are you looking for and how we, you know, how, where do you think our companies can go. Our door is open for anybody who needs help. And what we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be there ready with eyes open, hearts open, to listen to other Kareems when they emerge on the scene to be able to take them to the next level. That's what we can do.
Cool. Well, just so Hidayat doesn't kill me, we're going to stop the panel right here. I will tell you before we wrap up that all three of these guys are sticking around, and if they were planning on not sticking around, I just hopefully just embarrassed them into sticking around for a little bit longer. And I can tell you that some of them are interested in hearing about investment opportunities and, you know, at the angel and seed stage in you know, startup other, you know, existing startups. So please feel free to come and ask them questions, harass Amra about his story. Hidayat?
One more question.
Okay, so there's some really excited people in the back.
Hidayat, guard the door.
So, question to private equity. Do you see yourself going on a higher risk private equity fit companies anytime soon, or do you want to find more Kareems and Fawries? I know Kareem and Fawry are very different, but
short answer. As private equity, you take risk. It's the kind of risk we take. So as I said, you know, our qualifier, we need to see mature business models. We don't take business model risk in the classical sense. People have to have reached a certain stage and proved themselves as management, ability to take business to a certain scale, and have matured the business model to a certain scale. They need to have proved themselves. We don't take business model risk. We don't take idea risk. That's not what we're built for, and that's not what we're qualified for.
Do you see the next three companies that are exciting or eyes on?
I should ask Ahmed, he's the one who sends them our way.
Okay.
No, but actually, I mean, a couple of comments here. The private equity house, and especially, I mean, if with the experience it has, someone like Abraj, for example, will have the capacity to manage the risk and to assess the risk properly. But the question is, does the founder have the capacity to properly assess the risk before presenting the opportunity to them? And again, I mean, I'll take, for example, and it was a fantastic real-life story by Amr. It's this mode of excitement. Do you think, I mean, that in this mode of sensing, you know, success in fundraising coming very close to you, will you be in the right mindset to make the proper decisions? My advice is you should seek advice. From a friend, from a colleague, from someone who can help you with the structure, but at least someone who also can manage the excitement and help you find the right terms for the partnership. Because again, it's not about buying or selling, it's about a relationship that will start now and will continue for the foreseeable future. So again, that's one thing. On the private equity side, I would say the main problem that I would see today is the lack of funding vehicles for the medium size. So for example, again, if you want to raise $1 or $2 million, you have the right institutional setup that will help you do this. If you want to raise $50 million, definitely you have the right setup as well. But how many Fawries or Kareems have we lost along the way because you don't have institutional money that can help you raise $5 or $10 million? And again, that's maybe one area for private equities and for the investment community to start thinking about, and how we can enhance this particular weakness in the ecosystem.
Okay, a quick one. When assessing or evaluating a startup, what kind of KPI or metrics do you look for that startup?
I mean, I would imagine it depends is the answer.
You'll swing at that one? You'll swing at that one?
I don't invest in startups, but...
No, how about, let me suggest something else. Amr is actually investing in startups in his personal capacity, and I just outed an investor here, so come and you know, find him after this event. What are you looking for?
We're looking for two things. Regardless, KPIs is just a metric or a translation of something else. So I'm sure we'll work out what the KPIs are, so long as there is what we believe is a viable business model that will grow, okay, that has value in it, and there are the right people to make it grow. The KPIs are cosmetics afterwards. So if I were you pitching to investors, I would concentrate so much about the idea itself and how you are of value to this and how you can take it forward. Yeah.
Hidayat, we're not allowed any more
not
questions,
when you're
are
trying
we?
To raise $20 million, no, so qualify us. To be very clear.
Just a rule of thumb, forget about, you know, a price point, forget about, you know, someone valuing your idea at $1 million after a couple of weeks. Again, it's all about finding the right equation and the terms and conditions that will come with it. Because again, think about it as equation rather than a price point or even a price range.
Thank you, Ahmed. Thanks, Ahmed. Thanks, Waleed. Thanks, Amr.